thank you. It's a beautiful, beautiful hall. It's terrific to be in Seattle. I have to tell you, the weather is much, much better in Seattle than it is in New York at the moment. So it's a real delight. I wasn't planning to do this, but I will tell a story about the Gene Patent case, which really was a very exciting and a very important case. And what was at issue in that case was there was a company called Myriad Genetics that had been given a patent over two genes known as the BRCA1 gene and the BRCA2 gene, BRCA, the initial standing for breast cancer, because mutations in those genes correlated to a high genetic risk of either breast cancer or ovarian cancer. And because they had been given a patent on those two genes that literally exist in your body, they were the only company that then was able to test the genes to determine if you had the mutation and therefore were more susceptible to breast and ovarian cancer. And the consequences of a positive test were very serious for many women. Many women chose to have mastectomies or have hysterectomies if they tested positive. And so there was a lot of incentive to make sure the test was as good as it could possibly be from the patient's point of view, and also to be sure that there was an opportunity for a second opinion because the stakes were so high. And neither of those things were possible as long as Myriad Genetics had a monopoly on this gene. And it seemed to us wrong that a private corporation should be able to patent the genes within your body. And so the case ultimately made its way to the Supreme Court. And Myriad's principal argument in the case was you're not allowed to, under the law, to patent what is known as a law of nature or a natural product. You can't patent gravity, for example. But Myriad's claim was the patent they had was over the isolated gene, and the isolated gene did not actually exist in your body because in your body your genetic material is linked together into a chain. And what they did when they extracted the genes that they were concerned about was they snipped the chain, took out the two genes they were interested in, and then those genes existed in isolation, which was not a way that they existed in nature, and therefore they ought to be able to patent the isolated genes. This is a real long lead up to a joke. And so we had lost in the lower courts, and we filed our brief first, and we said, in essence, a gene is a gene is a gene. And they came back and they made the argument that I had just described, but by the time the case had reached the Supreme Court, they had thought of an analogy, because the science was lost on many of us, and there was a concern that the science would be lost on the Supreme Court. So they said, it is like when you take a limb off a tree and turn it into a baseball bat. You can patent the baseball bat because it's no longer the tree limb. And the lawyers in my office brought this into me, and I said, I really don't know anything about genetics or patents. I know baseball. They're not swinging a bat. They're swinging a tree limb. It's still the tree limb. They've done nothing to it. And they're no more entitled to patent the gene than they would be to patent the limb of the tree that they have now sawed off from its trunk. And then I thought I understood the whole case. And so did the Supreme Court, and as it turns out, we won 9-0. And I will say, and I'm very proud of this, that the among other things, the cost of that test for women around the world, as in the United States in particular, has now come down dramatically since that victory, because there are many more companies that are providing the genetic testing. So it was not an abstract legal principle; it was a case that had real world consequences for women for whom it was very, very important. But all that's in the past. Let's talk about the future. So for those of us like me who are paid to follow the Supreme Court, the last 2 weeks of June are like the 2 weeks before the Super Bowl. There's a lot of anticipation. I know you know about the Super Bowl in Seattle. We have forgotten about the Super Bowl in New York. The court seemingly, you know, inescapably, every year leaves its biggest and most controversial decisions until the end. There's nothing written anywhere that says the Supreme Court has to be done with its cases by the end of June. But they, like me, have discovered that July is a very nice time to take vacation. So they're all anxious to get out of DC, which is really hot and miserable in the summer. And so they're, in my memory, they've always completed their work by the end of June. And for those of you who do not know the way the Supreme Court works, the Supreme Court convenes every year on the first Monday in October. They hear arguments from October through April. In the months that they hear arguments 2 weeks out of every month. In the weeks that they hear argument 3 days out of every week. On the days that they hear argument for at most 2 hours a day. So if anybody asks you what you want to do for a second career, say, I want to be a Supreme Court Justice. But their last argument this year was on April 29th, and then from April 29th through the end of the June, they are just in the process of writing and issuing whatever decisions have not yet been decided. The Supreme Court this year heard argument in 67 cases. That number has gone down dramatically in recent years. In the mid and late 80s, the Supreme Court heard and decided about 140 cases a year. So they're now hearing half of the number of cases that they heard 3 decades ago. When John Roberts was going through the nomination process, one of the things he said in his confirmation hearings was he thought the court could hear more cases than they were hearing. That turns out not to have happened for whatever reason. So of the 67 cases that were argued this term, 50 have been decided so far. There were 3 opinions issued today. Which means that there are 17 opinions left to be decided, and probably 4 or 5 days on which the court will announce those opinions. So the next day that the court is going to issue decisions is on this Thursday. And they will issue decisions on Monday, June 22nd, then on Thursday, June 25th. Then on Monday, June 29th, my anniversary. And then if they're not done, I think they will issue decisions on Tuesday, June 30th, and then they will be done for the year. Every year in the Supreme Court is an important year. It's just the nature of the American political system. When Alexis de Tocqueville came through the United States in the 19th century, one of his observations was that the United States was a country in which all political disputes ultimately became legal disputes. That's not entirely true, but it's more true than not. Many of the major controversies of the day wind up in front of the Supreme Court. So every year there are important cases. Not every year is an historic year in the Supreme Court. This is an historic year in the Supreme Court. And that is because, as Kathleen said, one of the 17 cases that remains to be decided in the Supreme Court is the fate of same-sex marriage. So I was debating whether or not to talk about the marriage case at the beginning or the end of this little talk, but since I'm actually quite optimistic about the outcome of this case, I decided that I would wait until the end, because why not end on a high note? So I will come back to same-sex marriage. I want to start out with what is for me a much more depressing story, and it involves the death penalty. The death penalty is diminishing in the United States. There are more states that are repealing the death penalty, Nebraska being the most recent one a few weeks ago. Fewer states that have the death penalty actually execute anybody. And juries are more and more reluctant to sentence people to death. So the number of people sentenced to death is declining. The number of people executed in any given year is declining. But one person killed by the state is one person too many, and there are many more than one person who is being killed annually under capital punishment in the United States. Every state that now has the death penalty, and the federal government has the death penalty too. So the Boston Marathon bomber was just sentenced to death in a federal trial, not in a state trial. But in every jurisdiction that has the death penalty now, the way we execute people is through lethal injection. And the way lethal injection works, it's not quite as clean and pristine as it might be if you've ever put a pet to sleep. If you put a pet to sleep, it's painful as a pet owner. I am a pet owner. But it actually seems quite peaceful for the animal. Not true for lethal injection. So we use what is known as a three-drug protocol. And the first drug is supposed to be an anesthetic. The second drug is a paralytic. It literally paralyzes you. And the third drug stops your heart. But it stops your heart in a way that everybody agrees is intensely painful. Hence the first two drugs. The anesthetic is designed to ensure that you don't feel the pain. And the paralytic, as far as I can tell, is really designed to make sure that nobody who is witnessing the execution sees you writhing around on the table. Several years ago, there was a case brought to the Supreme Court out of Tennessee following a botched execution, and there have been a series of these botched executions if you've been reading the news reports. And the argument was the Eighth Amendment to the United States Constitution prohibits the state from imposing cruel and inhuman punishment, and if the state is executing you in a way that amounts to torture, it is a violation of the Eighth Amendment under the Constitution. That's the argument. And in the Tennessee case, the lawyers went to the United States Supreme Court and said, look, they're making mistakes. For one reason they're making mistakes is the people administering the drugs are often not medical personnel, they're prison personnel. They don't always know what they're doing. Anesthesia is a very tricky business to figure out the correct dosage and to figure out how to inject it properly in the drug, in the body. And when they make mistakes, as they have, the consequences are catastrophic, and so you ought to put an end to this. You ought to say this is not a permissible means of execution. And the Supreme Court said no. They said the mere fact that there are mistakes every now and then is, you know, a constitutional form of collateral damage. It's regrettable, but it doesn't render the entire process unconstitutional, because if it were done right, the person being condemned to death would actually not feel pain. Following that decision, what happened was there was actually a conscious decision made by the drug companies, primarily in Europe, which have a very strong anti-death penalty tradition, not to supply the anesthesia that was used in capital punishment in the United States to the states that wanted it. Because the American population was concerned about it, but much more importantly, their market in Europe was concerned that their drugs were being used for the purposes of lethal injection. And so the European suppliers stopped providing the anesthesia. And the states that wanted to execute people then found they didn't have the drugs that they needed to execute, carry out the executions. And so what they started to do was first they would go to drug companies that didn't really supply they were not in the business of producing the drugs that were needed. And then ultimately, states like Oklahoma had to switch the first drug. They couldn't get the anesthesia they needed. And so they started to use another drug that was never intended to be an anesthetic, it was intended to be a sedative. And sedatives can dull the pain and put you to sleep, but they're not the same as anesthesia. And so now, lawyers for a death row inmate in Oklahoma have gone back to the United States Supreme Court and said, look, what you said in case number one from Tennessee was the procedure was constitutional as long as the state was using drugs that, if they worked the way they were supposed to work, would allow for a painless execution. But now the state is using drugs that, even if administered properly, cannot ensure a painless death, because that's not what these drugs were designed to do. So the problem is no longer the risk of misadministration, maladministration. Now the problem is, right, the procedure is inherently flawed. So that's the case. And it gets argued on April 29th of this year. It's the final day of the Supreme Court term. And I just want to read a passage from the transcript of the Supreme Court argument in this case, because I find it so disturbing. In the middle of the argument, and when arguments take place in the Supreme Court, each side gets 30 minutes. It's actually not very long. It's less time than I'm going to be speaking to you. Right? And that's, by and large, true, no matter how important the case is. So each side gets 30 minutes, and it's not 30 uninterrupted minutes. You're constantly being asked questions by the members of the court. So the lawyer for the defendant, the death row inmate, is making his argument. And Justice Alito asks him a question. And he says, it's sort of a question, it's more of a speech. He says, let's be honest about what is going on here. Executions could be carried out painlessly. There are many jurisdictions. There are jurisdictions in this country, there are jurisdictions abroad that allow assisted suicide, and I assume that these are carried out with little if any pain. Oklahoma and other states could carry out executions painlessly. Now this court, Supreme Court, has held that the death penalty is constitutional. It's controversial as a constitutional matter. It certainly is controversial as a policy matter. There are those who oppose the death penalty, and they are free to try to persuade legislatures to abolish the death penalty. Some of those efforts have been successful. They're free to ask this court to overrule the death penalty. But until that occurs, is it appropriate for the judiciary to countenance what amounts to a guerrilla war against the death penalty? Just think of that phrasing. A guerrilla war against the death penalty, which consists of efforts to make it impossible for the states to obtain drugs that could be used to carry out capital punishment with little, if any, pain. And so the states are reduced to using drugs like this one, which give rise to disputes about whether, in fact, every possibility of pain is eliminated. Now, what is your response to that? And the lawyer says, well, Justice Alito, the purpose of the courts is to decide whether a method of execution or the way that the state is going to carry out an execution is in fact constitutional. And it's whether we're going to tolerate it. Is it intolerable to allow the states to carry out a method in this way? And then Justice Scalia jumps in. And he says, I guess I would be more inclined to find that it was intolerable if there was even some doubt about this drug when there was a perfectly safe other drug available. But the states have gone through two different drugs, and those drugs have been rendered unavailable by the abolitionist movement, putting pressure on the companies that manufactured them so that the states cannot obtain those two other drugs. And now you want to come before this court and say, well, this third drug is not 100% sure. The reason it isn't 100% sure is because the abolitionists have rendered it impossible to get the 100% sure drugs. And you think we should not view that as relevant to the decision? And the lawyer says, Justice Scalia, I don't think it is relevant. And then Justice Ginsburg jumps in to try to rescue him. And then Justice Kennedy jumps in, because he understands what Justice Ginsburg is doing. And he says, in response to the answer to Ginsburg's question, he says, that doesn't answer Justice Scalia's and Justice Alito's question. And there's a little back and forth, and finally Justice Kennedy says, I would like an answer to the question. You've been interrupted several times and you still haven't given it. Is it relevant or not? And the lawyer says, it's not relevant. Now the answer is, of course it's not relevant. And more profoundly than that, the idea that we would allow any state in this country to execute a person using a method that we reasonably understand to be likely to fail, and that the consequences of failure are to subject that person to a form of torture in his final minutes of earth because some other people have exercised their constitutional rights to object to the death penalty by trying to persuade companies not to supply drugs that can be used in lethal executions, is not only a constitutionally indefensible position, in my view, it's an immoral position. And it's also a disingenuous position from members of the court who otherwise believe in the free market. This is the way the market is supposed to work. Your customers don't want you producing a product, you stop producing it because the income you make from selling this product to the state is not worth the income you're going to lose if other people organize a consumer boycott. What's wrong with that? Right? The conclusion to that sentence cannot be, and therefore we use what would otherwise be an unconstitutional form of capital punishment. So, as I say, the case was argued on April 29th. It's one of the 17 cases remaining to be decided. You know, at this point, it's a matter of days, one way or the other. But my guess is that that's a case that will, you know, be decided sometime in the last week of June. And it's not, frankly, a case on which I am feeling particularly optimistic at the moment. I wanted to talk about then two free speech cases that are before the court. And the first one is a case that in anticipation was widely perceived as a case in which the court was going to say something about free speech on the internet. And since I'm in Seattle, I thought I would talk about a case involving free speech on the internet. And as with so many free speech cases, the facts of this case are particularly disturbing. Defendant is a man in Pennsylvania who works at a theme park and who is in the midst of a bitter separation from his wife. And he winds up posting on his Facebook page a series of statements, comments, that initially are just comments and then ultimately are wrapped up into rap lyrics. He writes rap lyrics embodying comments that talk about engaging in violence against his ex-wife and against his coworkers. And when he ultimately gets visited by the FBI, he then posts something talking about responding violently to the FBI. And he gets arrested for violating federal law, which makes it a crime to engage in threats in interstate commerce, and anything you say on the internet is engaging in interstate commerce. And the question that comes before the Supreme Court is in some ways a real lawyer's question, but in other ways is a question of you know, potential significance in the real world. The government's position in the case, the First Amendment does not protect your right to threaten people. You do not have a right to threaten people. But there's also a lot of rhetoric, personal and political, which borders on the threatening. And so the difficult question has been, how do you decide what is what the Supreme Court calls a true threat, and what is just verbal hyperbole? Inappropriate, troubling, but not criminal. And the Supreme Court, the government's position, the United States government's position in the case was, what you have to do is you have to think about the listener, and if a reasonable listener, the target, the ex-wife in this case, would perceive the words as threatening her with bodily harm or death, that's a threat. Because we're worried about the impact of the speech on the person against whom it was directed. Right? We took the position, we the ACLU took the position, that that was one part of the inquiry. But that in addition, you had to, the government had to prove that the speaker actually intended the words to be taken as a threat. And that legal position that the government had to prove not only that the listener understood the words to be a threat, but the speaker intended the words to be a threat, is a position that we adopted from Thurgood Marshall. And Thurgood Marshall took that position because he was worried back in the 70s, based on his experience as a civil rights lawyer, that unless you required the government to prove that the speaker intended the words to be a threat, you would have threat statutes used to prosecute civil rights advocates and other political dissidents whose words were deemed to be threatening by those whom they were criticizing. And that the requirement of proving the speaker's intent was a necessary safeguard for protecting unpopular speakers. And that's what we said to the Supreme Court. Embodied in that was this discussion that when you were trying to figure out either part of that equation, how would a reasonable person who was the target of the speech understand it? And how do we figure out what was in the speaker's mind? Does the fact that the speech occurred on the internet matter? Does context matter? Normally we'd say context matters. It's how you figure out what's going on in somebody's head. And which way does the context of the internet work? Does it make us more tolerant of abusive speech because the internet can sometimes be a free speech wild west and nobody takes it quite seriously? Or does it mean that the speech is even more threatening because of your ability to reach a larger audience and to do it relatively simply and sometimes even anonymously? Turns out that the Supreme Court ruled for the defendants that the government had to prove that the speaker acted with a malicious intent, but it did so not on the basis of free speech cases of principles, but on the basis of an old and ancient principle of criminal law, which John Roberts, who wrote the opinion, summarized by saying that wrongdoing must be conscious to be criminal. Right? Now, the reason I tell that story is not because this case, especially as it was decided, is so enormously significant, but it is because when the ACLU is trying to figure out what position to take in any particular case, and especially when the facts are as troubling as they are in a case like this, one of the things we have to worry about, one of the things that the Supreme Court has to worry about, is how the rule of law they announce on these facts in this case will affect other cases, right, that we might care more about. And so one of the exercises that I do in the office all the time when we were trying to figure out how we feel about a government effort to regulate or suppress speech is to say to the other lawyers in our office, imagine for a moment that the politics were switched. And instead of trying to prohibit or regulate the speech of somebody you disagree with, the government was using exactly that same power to regulate or prohibit the speech of somebody you agree with. Would you be willing to tolerate it because the rule has to be the same in both cases? And that issue comes up even more forcefully in a second free speech case that the court has not yet decided. It's one of those 17 cases, but now you can look forward over the next 2 weeks. And the name of this case is called Walker versus Sons of the Confederate Veterans. And the case comes out of Texas, and Texas, like many states, has what they call a specialty license plate program. I don't know if Washington State does. My guess is it does. Most states do it. It's a way of generating revenue. So it's not a vanity plate. It's not when you go to the state and say, I want my license plate to say ACLU and give them a certain fee in order to get that personal license plate. Here, what happens is you get whatever license plate the state is going to give you, but the rules differ from state to state. But generally, they say if you get a certain threshold of people to sign up and say, we would like our license plate in addition to say ACLU under you know, state of Washington, the state will produce those license plates and it'll charge you a fee, and it'll, but it'll only do it if you get 300 or 500 or 1,000 people to say you want them. So in Texas, what happened was, there's an organization called the Sons of the Confederate Veterans. It's, you know, their version of the Daughters of the American Revolution. And they get whatever the threshold number is, and they send in an application to the state of Texas, and they say to the state of Texas, in addition, on our license plate that says Texas and, you know, Lone Star State and has our license plate number, we would also like our license plate to say Sons of Confederate Veterans and have a Confederate flag on the license plate. And state of Texas, for reasons that still escape me, say, we're not going to give you that license plate because the Confederate flag will be offensive to a significant number of other drivers on the highway who are going to be forced to look at it because it's now on your license plate. Now, when Texas discovered this racial sensitivity, I'm not quite sure. But at some level, more power to them, right? So they say, we're not going to give you the license plate because your message is offensive. That case is now in the Supreme Court. We filed a brief supporting the Sons of the Confederate Veterans. It's not easy to file those briefs. It's not easy to write those briefs. But I'm going to tell you why we did it. Because at the same time that case was in the United States Supreme Court, we had our own case that was in the United States Supreme Court. And our case came from North Carolina. North Carolina has a specialty license plate program. And what happened in North Carolina was the state of North Carolina said, we will make specialty license plates that say pro-life. We will not create specialty license plates that say pro-choice. And we don't care how many people ask for the pro-choice license plates, we're not making them. I like that reaction. You should be on the Supreme Court. And so those two cases went to the Supreme Court simultaneously, and the Supreme Court gets to pick and choose its cases, and it chose the case out of Texas and not our case out of North Carolina. But our case out of North Carolina is sitting there, right? And when they decide the Texas case, whatever rule of law they apply in the Texas case is going to determine the result in the North Carolina case. And I tell the story not, as I said, because any of this is simple or easy. But there is one reaction when you just think about the license plate with the Confederate flag, and another reaction when you think about empowering the state to say we're going to create pro-life but not respect choice license plates. But it's the same principle. And the principle is the state doesn't get to pick and choose the political positions it likes and the political positions it dislikes. That's what the First Amendment disables it from doing, and that's why we took the position that we took in that case. All right. Let me tell you, now of course I look up and I see I have 5 minutes left, so I can't. But let me just tell you about one other case quickly, and then I want to talk about marriage. And this is another case yet to be decided, but an enormously important civil rights battle. During the 1960s, Congress passed three great civil rights statutes. They passed the 1964 Civil Rights Act, which prohibits discrimination in employment and public accommodations. Passed with the sort of at the urging of Lyndon Johnson after the assassination of President Kennedy. In 1965, Congress passes the Voting Rights Act, following the March on Selma. In 1968, Congress passes something called the Fair Housing Act, shortly after Martin Luther King's assassination. And the Fair Housing Act says, in essence, thou shalt not discriminate in housing. And there are all sorts of forms that discrimination can take. The simplest and, you know, most obvious is when you send two couples to a landlord and the African-American couple shows up first in the apartment building and says, we'd like to rent an apartment, and they're told there is no apartment for you, and a white couple arrives an hour later and they're shown three apartments. But there are also much, much more subtle forms of race discrimination that take place in housing and lending. And the housing bubble that burst in 2008 was built on a series of lending policies and practices by banks and investment companies that had a markedly disproportionate impact on communities of color. The people that were sold the bad loans disproportionately came from communities of color, right? The issue before the Supreme Court in this case is, if you're going to claim discrimination under the Fair Housing Act, this is not a criminal case, so don't get it confused with the threats case. It's not a criminal case. You're suing for money now. Do you have to prove that the defendant, the landlord, the bank that gave you the mortgage under unfavorable terms intended to discriminate on the basis of race, or is it enough to show that they adopted practices that had a racially discriminatory impact? This law has been on the books for almost 50 years. Every single federal court beneath the United States Supreme Court has had an opportunity to interpret it over those five decades. And every single court has come to the conclusion that all you need to show is that the practice you were challenging had a discriminatory impact and not that it was driven by a racist motive, because racist motives are really hard to prove. And Congress in 50 years has never seen fit to change the law if they thought it was being misinterpreted. And now the Supreme Court, after 50 years and uniform judicial interpretations and congressional inaction, has decided it wants to take another look at the statute. And if it decides that what Congress intended, to everybody's surprise 50 years ago, was to require proof of discriminatory intent, these cases are going to be very, very hard to prove. And if these cases become very, very hard to prove, it's going to remove another level of accountability against the lenders and the mortgage companies and the big landlords, right, who are engaging in practices that have negative impact on communities of color. So it's an important case to watch, and it's going to come down sometime in the next week or two. Okay, marriage. This is a nice story. But I'll back it up, because I find this an interesting part of the story. You know, it's always tempting when you talk about same-sex marriage, and I'd say this as well, to say, the progress we have made in a short period of time is incredible. And unlike anything any of us who work in this business have ever seen. The first state to recognize same-sex marriage was Massachusetts in 2003. Here we are 12 years later, we have 37 states. And I think we are poised to have 50. And so you're... And so you're tempted to say, boy, that was fast. But of course, it wasn't fast. Because that 12 years of rapid progress followed centuries, if not millennia, of no progress at all. And it's important to remember that. We are not correcting a new injustice, we are correcting a very ancient injustice. And when Massachusetts became the first state to recognize same-sex marriage in 2003, there was a lot of discussion about how to build on that decision in a way that would help hopefully create a movement and create momentum so that same-sex couples in other states could enjoy what same-sex couples in Massachusetts were now able to enjoy. And there was a very conscious decision to talk about the case and to talk about the issue, not in terms of love, because there was a worry that if you talked about love between two men and two women, people thought about sex. And when people thought about gay and lesbian sex, it made them uncomfortable, so let's not go there. And if you look back at the stories that emerged from 2003 and 2004 and 2005 and 2006, what you will see is the narrative of a couple that's been together for several decades and one gets seriously ill and the partner can't get into the intensive care unit because only family members are allowed into the intensive care unit, and other stories like that, which were immensely powerful and had an impact and moved the needle of public opinion. But then there was another set of polls done in 2008 and 2009, and the question that was asked, it was a little more sophisticated than this, but the basic question that was asked is, why do straight people get married? And the answer was, they're in love. And the question was, why do gay and lesbians get married? And the answer was, they want the benefits, right? And as long as, and even if people thought they were entitled to the benefits, as long as that was true, it enabled the American public to create a we, they narrative, right? They are different than we, right? And so you see then a very dramatic shift in the way the story is told, because you can learn from your mistakes, right? And now the story becomes, people in love are entitled to marry the people they love, regardless of who they are. And Edie Windsor's case goes to the United States Supreme Court in 2013. The ACLU is part of her legal team. And she is a walking advertisement for love. She had a 45-year relationship with her partner, Thea Speier. She talked of her in the most loving terms, and her story became universally embraced. What the Edie Windsor case was actually about is when her partner dies, she was required to pay inheritance taxes on what she had inherited from Thea Speier, because since they were not married, she didn't get the exemption that comes when one spouse dies and the property goes to another. So it was actually a case about money. But nobody remembers that it was a case about money. It was a case about love. So now, following the Supreme Court's decision in the Edie Windsor case, states around the country begin to fall like dominoes. Some do it, like New York State did, by a vote of the state legislature. Others do it as a result of court orders. But federal courts around the country almost uniformly say, we can no longer tolerate a system in which two people who love each other are denied the right to marry because they happen to be members of the same sex. Until a case comes before the United States Court of Appeals, one level before the United States Supreme Court, in the Midwest, and they are reviewing laws from four states that prohibit same-sex marriage: Kentucky, Ohio, Tennessee, and Michigan. And they write a decision upholding those laws, breaking with almost every other court in the country. And it's that case that is now before the United States Supreme Court. The lead plaintiff, the name of the case, is Jim Obergefell. The case that established the right to interracial marriage under the Constitution of the United States had the much more felicitous name of Loving versus Virginia. We now have Obergefell versus Hodges, but be that as it may. And the Supreme Court, now faced with this decision saying that these four states could continue to deny marriage rights, decided it had to intervene. I don't think the court wanted to get into this battle as quickly as it could, but history just ran away. Too much was happening too quickly. It couldn't stay out anymore. And as it sometimes did, the court directed the lawyers, because there were four states, right, laws from four states that were all put together in a single case that goes to the Supreme Court, directed the lawyers to argue two questions. The first question was, does the federal constitution require every state to license marriages for same-sex couples? Does every same-sex couple have the right to be married in the state in which they live? The second question, which only becomes relevant if the answer to the first question is no, is does the federal constitution require every state to recognize a valid marriage from another state? So if you live in a state that doesn't allow gays and lesbians to marry, but you travel to a state that does and then come back to your home state, does your home state have to recognize your marriage from out of state? Which, of course, states do all the time. Many people get married in other states and then come back to their home state, and we just accept as a given that that marriage is valid and recognized where you live as well as where it was performed. So the first issue is a licensing question. Do you have a right to get married in your own state? The second is a recognition question. And when the court said, those are the two questions we want answered, there was some concern that maybe the court saw some compromise here. Maybe the court was going to say, you don't have a right to get married everywhere, but any place you do get married, your marriage has to be recognized when you come back to your home state. That would be progress, but that would be, at this point, I think, a major setback, because it would still be treating gay and lesbian couples as second-class citizens, because they are deprived of the right that all straight couples take for granted, and that is to the right to get married wherever they want to get married. When the case was argued on April 27th, it seemed pretty clear that the court was not really interested in the second question, the recognition question, that they had come to some understanding that this had now, we had reached the point that this was an up or down vote on marriage. And there was something very interesting about the way the argument proceeded, because for so many years, the principal argument against gay marriage, the argument you heard all the time, the fear-mongering that you heard, was it's bad for the kids. Right? Nobody says that anymore. And in fact, now that argument has completely turned around. And Justice Kennedy, who was always the critical fifth vote in these cases, has made it perfectly clear that the kids he is worried about are the kids who are already being raised by same-sex couples all over the country, and their right to be raised in a relationship that receives full recognition from the state. So the defenders of same-sex marriage bans don't talk about the kids anymore. And so when you don't have the kids to talk about, well, what do you talk about? Well, one thing to talk about is, as the lower court opinion said in this case, it's not a question of should we have same-sex marriage, but who gets to decide. This is a question that ought to be decided by the democratic process and not a question that is decided by judges, activist judges. The problem with that argument is, first of all, you're talking to the judges who are going to decide. And secondly, that's why we have a constitution. We have a constitution because there are certain rights that we deem so fundamental that we do not put them up to majority vote. And it is the responsibility of judges to announce and to enforce those constitutional rights. So then the argument, which is one step removed from that, becomes, well, but the decisions ought to be made by the states, because the states generally regulate marriage. The federal government doesn't regulate marriage, and the Supreme Court has said on many occasions that the states are principally responsible for marriage laws. So let the states experiment. And after all, this is relatively new, and why can't a state like Michigan decide, I want to wait and see how this works out in crazy Washington state before we leap in and make a decision that's going to bind our own citizens in Michigan? You know, why shouldn't this be a local decision as opposed to a national decision? And the answer to that question is very simple. Because we have a federal constitution. And when Virginia came to the United States Supreme Court in 1967 and said it's very well and good for New York State to allow interracial marriages, but the people in the Commonwealth of Virginia have made another decision and marriage is a state prerogative and you ought to respect that, the Supreme Court said not a chance. You have a right to make any decision you want about marriage as long as it's not an unconstitutional decision, and prohibiting interracial marriage is unconstitutional, just as prohibiting same-sex marriage is unconstitutional. States don't get to violate the Constitution. So if you don't have the kids and you don't have democracy and you don't have states' rights, what argument do you have? And if you go back and listen to this argument, it's available on the Supreme Court website. You can listen to it, right? The principal argument on the other side is that marriage is and always has been about procreation. And if you can't procreate, you have no interest in the institution of marriage, and the state has no obligation to extend it to you. Now, of course, you're talking to a Supreme Court whose youngest member is in her 50s.
Right.
And whose Chief Justice has adopted his own children. And it's a little hard and insulting to say that marriage is not about a bond between two people. It's not about shared commitment and responsibility. It's about creating children. And as, you know, somebody asked in the course of this argument, we let people who are beyond their reproductive years get married. We let people who are sterile get married. We don't ask people when we give out the marriage license, do you intend to have children? Right? Where does this come from? What is this about? And what quickly becomes obvious is that there is no there, right? And what this is about is an effort to maintain a system of laws that was born out of prejudice, born out of prejudice, you know, perpetrated through hatred and sustained through ignorance. And at the end of the day, the exchange in the death penalty case with which I began this discussion, talk notwithstanding, I have faith and confidence that the Supreme Court will do the right thing here. And when they do the right thing, it's going to be met with a spattering of opposition in predictable places, but overwhelmingly with a collective yawn. After the party. First there'll be a party. Then there'll be a yawn. And when our kids read about it, they're going to say, what took you so long? And indeed, what took you so long? So, you know, we will get some good and some bad in the next 2 weeks. But if the marriage case comes out the way I hope and expect it to, then we can all look back on this year with a great deal of satisfaction. So thank you very much.
Are there any movements to change, simplify, or remove the Patriot Act constraints in the banking business?
The short answer is not at the moment. As you probably know and have read, Congress just passed a new law called the USA Freedom Act that was designed, and in some ways does, limit the government's power now to engage in bulk collection of telephone metadata, the first revelation from Edward Snowden. That was a difficult battle, but it is the first time since 9/11 that any of the government surveillance powers have been, in fact, reined in at all. So it was significant progress, but that debate did not focus on the banking regulations. And you know, there's a lot of talk about changing aspects of the Patriot Act, but the focus at the moment was on the mass surveillance programs.
Thank you. What are your thoughts on Associate Justice William O. Douglas and his conviction that universities should be freed of CIA and Pentagon influence and control?
Well, if I'm not mistaken, Justice Douglas came from Washington, so I've got to love him. We have I digress here for a moment, but we have an ACLU story. There was a brief moment in time where the ACLU filed, successfully got an injunction against the war in Cambodia during the height of the Vietnam War, because there had never been any congressional authorization to engage in war in Cambodia as opposed to Vietnam. And as part of that, lasted for about 36 seconds, but as part of that 36 seconds, there is an ACLU lawyer who tells a wonderful story about trying to track down Justice Douglas in Yakima, Washington, and knocking on the door of his cabin and getting him to sign some papers that would stop the bombers from flying until the other eight people in Washington overruled him. I believe strongly in the principle of academic freedom. I think academic freedom is critical to the enterprise. It is the sort of crown jewel of any university. And if we don't respect and protect academic freedom, why do we have universities? I don't think that means that the Defense Department or the CIA need to be banished from universities. I think that there is a dialogue that can take place that includes those particular political viewpoints, but I don't think either overtly or covertly that any institution of government, but certainly those, ought to be trying to control what is being taught or researched at universities.
And I think it was Goose Prairie where Justice Douglas had his cabin, and it is outside Yakima.
It's west of the Hudson River, isn't it?
Steve, one of our audience members wants to know if you would have supported the Confederate flag case on its own merits without the other case.
Yes, but that's because it was not hard to anticipate or hypothesize the other case. So the other case didn't have to be there. And the thing about being an ACLU lawyer is, more often than not, we are representing people who are politically unpopular and often politically powerless. So it is very easy to go through an exercise that just says, imagines what the rules would look like if they were turned against the people we are representing. And as I said, for a host of reasons, some very principled and some very pragmatic, I really do believe that it's essential as a matter of constitutional law, essential for the credibility of the ACLU, that we adopt and maintain and pursue a set of legal rules that applies to everybody and not just to the people we happen to like. Because the people we happen to like are often not going to be liked by the people who have the power to make the rules. And once you give them the discretion to draw those lines, we're going to lose much more often than we're going to win.
For you personally, Steve, what has been the most morally challenging case you've had to argue?
Well, I think, you know, one of the things about being at the, I'm going to give a general answer, not a specific answer. Because the ACLU is a multi-issue organization, right? There are many organizations out there that do terrific work and they focus on a single issue. The ACLU focuses on the range of constitutional issues. And what that sometimes means is that there are cases that arise when there are rights, competing rights at stake, where when it's a question of individual rights against the government, it may be an easy or hard case to win, but the ACLU position is usually pretty clear. But when it's a case where both sides are claiming individual rights and you have to make a difficult judgment, whether it's a hate speech case where somebody says, I have a First Amendment right to say horrible racist things, and then you have somebody else who comes in and says those words have impact, right, on my community and on me personally and on my ability to function in this world, right? Or when you have, believe as we do, in the right of reproductive choice, which means the right of access to abortion, not only the theoretical right to an abortion, but the right to actually get into an abortion clinic. And at the same time, you believe that people have the right to protest and express their disagreement with abortion, even though that's not our view. They have a First Amendment right to do that, and you have to figure out how do you reconcile the rights of the protesters with the rights of the abortion clinic providers and patients. Those are always very difficult and hard cases for us.
Steve, do you have some thoughts on the ACA cases before the Supreme Court?
ACA being the healthcare statute, AKA Obamacare. The ACLU did not participate in this case, let me just say that at the beginning, and then I guess I have to describe what this case is about very briefly. If you recall, 2 years ago, the same term the court decided the E.D. Windsor case, there was a direct frontal challenge to the Affordable Care Act. The argument was Congress had exceeded its authority in adopting the statute at all. And had that argument prevailed, the whole statute would have been gone. It would have been over. And it survived, you know, by the narrowest of margins, a 5-4 vote in an opinion written by Chief Justice Roberts, who, you know, some people think changed his mind in the midst of the process. But Obamacare, in any event, survived. The challenge this year is more focused, but potentially as lethal. And that is because the principle underlying the Affordable Care Act is in order to enable insurance companies to provide insurance for everybody who needs it, including, for example, those with pre-existing conditions. It is important to increase the pool of people who are being insured, and in particular, the pool of healthy people who purchase insurance premiums, because they do not cost the insurance companies as much since they are healthy most of the time. And so the Affordable Care Act did that in two ways. One was requiring everybody to buy insurance. And the other one was to say, but if you can't afford it, we will help subsidize it. And the provision of the law that authorizes the federal subsidy says, a federal subsidy shall be available on any health care exchange established by a state. And what happened after the law was passed, as you probably know, is that many states, the majority of states, in fact, decided not to establish their own health care exchanges, all in Republican states. And the federal government then stepped in and created exchanges in the states when the state government would not do it on their own. And the federal subsidy has been available in every health care exchange, regardless of whether it was established by the federal government or by the state government. And the plaintiffs in this case come in and said, you can't provide the federal subsidy in states where the healthcare exchange was established by the federal government, because the statute says you can only provide a subsidy in an exchange that was established by the state. If that position prevails, It means the federal subsidy will be eliminated in the majority of states that do not have state-created health care exchanges. The pool of insured will decrease, and there is a risk that the entire scheme collapses like a house of cards, because there just are not enough people in the system. And the legal problem with it is that even though the statute says established by the state, almost everybody agrees it was a drafting mistake, that this is a big, enormous, comprehensive statute. They didn't at the time anticipate that states would refuse to create their own healthcare exchanges. They didn't anticipate the problem that arose, and that what they really meant to say was an exchange established in a state, not by a state. But the words are what the words are. And so I think this is going to be a very, very close case, and probably another 5-4 case. I don't have a prediction, but I certainly don't think this is an easy or certain victory for the administration, and I think there's a real threat, a risk that the court could go the other way and then leave it to Congress to fix. But this Congress won't fix it, right?
Practically speaking, what do you think can be done about Citizens United, and are you optimistic about correcting it?
The answer is, I think honestly, that this Supreme Court is not about to reverse itself. If there is another Supreme Court, they might. The court is on Citizens United, as on so many other things, divided 5-4. It's why the composition and the makeup of the court matters, why when we enter into presidential election, you ought to be thinking, one thing you ought to be thinking about when you think about the candidate of your choice is whoever you elect is going to have the ability to replace several members of the Supreme Court in a way that could change its ideological balance. But as long as these 9 people are on the Supreme Court, it's not going to change. And the only way it can be changed externally is by constitutional amendment. And honestly, I don't think that's going to happen, and I think it would be a bad idea to try it. I think you do not want to open the First Amendment up to constitutional revision. You may think you're worried about Citizens United, and you open up the First Amendment, and who knows what we wind up with. But what I say to people all the time is this. The reason that money is powerful in politics is because of the perception that money can influence elections. Right? Money enables you to buy advertising, money enables you to do all sorts of things that give you strategic advantages in a campaign. But at the end of the day, what wins elections is not money, it's not advertising, is votes. And if everybody who objected and who objects the Citizens United gets out and votes, votes can trump money. And so the way to, you're not going to reverse Citizens United, but you can neuter Citizens United by exercising the franchise.
Could you talk a little bit about Hobby Lobby case and how concerned the ACLU is with it?
Yeah, people are using shorthand that I'm not quite sure, you know, how commonly shared the shorthand is. Hobby Lobby was a case in the Supreme Court last year, also under the Affordable Care Act. I'll try to do this a little more quickly, but the Affordable Care Act said that when employers provide insurance to their employees through their employment, the insurance must include coverage for preventive services, and it then said the Department of Health and Human Services shall create a list of preventive services that have to be included in the basic insurance practice package. And the Department of Health and Human Services then produced a list that included many preventive services, but among them contraception, because contraception actually reduces in the cost of healthcare by preventing unwanted pregnancies, and contraception is much less expensive than the cost of prenatal care, or for that matter, the cost of an abortion. So it's an insurance savings, not an insurance cost. And Hobby Lobby is a privately owned held company whose owners had religious objections to what they saw as subsidizing the use of certain contraceptives that they regarded as equivalent to abortion. And they said the government ought not to be able to force us to violating our religious principles by requiring us to subsidize contraceptive services for our employees. The argument on many levels never made a lot of sense to me, because when your employer buys you an insurance package, he's not in any way endorsing what you do with that insurance any more than when your employer gives you a paycheck, he's endorsing the fact that you may use part of that paycheck to go buy abortion or buy contraception or do a host of things that your employer may disagree with. But the Supreme Court said that the Hobby Lobby owners had a religious right to opt out, and then the administration essentially created a workaround for employees in that company. The real worry is, and the place that the fight is going after we hopefully win marriage at the end of this term, is around this issue of discrimination and religious opt-outs or religious refusals, as we call it. And one thing that you should know, because after the cheering dies down, if we are cheering, the majority of states in this country and the federal government do not have discrimination laws on the books that prohibit discrimination on the basis of sexual orientation. So if we win the right to marry in all 50 states, in a majority of states in this country, a couple can get married on Saturday and be fired from their job on Monday because they got married on Saturday night. And so there's going to be a push, and there already is a push, to create anti-discrimination laws, and that's going to create a backlash to create religious exemptions to those anti-discrimination laws. And that is very much where the fight is going. If you read the news, you will know that there was a fight about that in Indiana. There was a fight about that in Arkansas recently. What's interesting now, and this is just evidence of the shift in public opinion, most major corporations line up on the side of anti-discrimination because they think it is bad for business. And so the corporations, the Fortune 500 corporations have become our allies in this fight, but Hobby Lobby has laid the seed for a religious opt-out that we're going to have to sort of deal with in the coming years, and is very troublesome from my point of view.
Thank you. I think we have time for maybe one or two more. Mass incarceration is a huge problem. Is anything being done about it through the courts, and could anything be done about it through the courts?
Mass incarceration is a huge problem. There are 2.3 million people behind bars in the United States. The United States has 5% of the world's population, 25% of the world's prison population. There are major prison facilities in this country that are essentially now nursing homes because the population is so old that the prison has been converted into a de facto nursing home. It's a policy that never made any sense and doesn't make any sense, that is racially discriminatory and fiscally bankrupting us. And there has been, in the last couple of years, I think, a remarkable shift in public opinion. And after 40 years of believing that the solution to social problems was to lock up more people for longer periods of time, there is now a consensus developing across parties and across ideologies that we have to look to alternatives to incarceration. So in the long run, I'm actually very hopeful, and reducing mass incarceration has become a major priority of the ACLU. I confuse the ACLU and the United States a lot. And we have created a goal for ourselves of reducing the prison population by 50% by 2025. Even then, we're talking about over a million people in jail, which would still be a lot of people. It's a very hard problem to solve through litigation. There are parts of it that can be solved through litigation, but the big change is going to come through the political process, and the political process will move only if the people responsible for the political process are feeling pressure from people like you. And so I think this is an issue that really needs a mass movement, is building a mass movement, and I think is going to be successful, but largely politically, not through the courts.
On an entirely different topic, since the FISA Amendment acts, not the Patriot Act, provide the legal basis for the majority of NSA spying, including the PRISM program, is the ACLU pursuing any legal challenges to these laws, and what might these challenges consist of?
We are. You'll be happy to know. We never seen a law that we couldn't sue over. And so we have recently filed a lawsuit against an aspect of the prison program, representing, among others, Wikimedia, which is the parent company of Wikipedia. And because of the way that legal doctrine is in this country, it's very, very difficult and nearly impossible to challenge or protest U.S. government surveillance of foreigners abroad. And so what you have to do, and what we have done in this case, and it makes sense because it's an inherent part of the program, is to challenge the aspect of the program that enables the government to spy on American citizens and the email and other electronic digital communications of people living in the United States. Those communications can't be targeted under the program, but they are nonetheless swept up in prodigious quantities as a byproduct of the PRISM program. And so we have brought a lawsuit challenging that.
The Supreme Court recently refused to hear a case overturning a lower court decision on invasive procedures required prior to abortions. Can you speak to that?
Yes, this is hot off the presses. This was a decision today, or a non-decision today. The Supreme Court decided not to review a lower court decision in a case brought by the ACLU and some other groups, challenging a really offensive law. I mean, all of these laws are offensive, so it's hard often to rank them. But in North Carolina, which required doctors to perform what came to be known as a narrated sonogram, no less than 4 hours before a woman obtained an abortion. And the narrated sonogram requirement had two parts. One, the doctor had to conduct the sonogram, whether or not the patient wanted it. And secondly, while the image was on, the sonogram image was on the screen, the doctor was then required by law to describe to the woman exactly what he was seeing on the screen. The fetus is so big, I can see toes, I can see fingers, you know, I can see organs of one sort or another, I can identify the sex. Whatever he was able to observe in the image, he then had to relay to the woman as she was lying on the operating table, half naked, waiting to go in and have her abortion. And the law was perfectly clear that the doctor had to do all of those things, even if the woman covered her eyes and sang throughout the entire process, so that she was neither seeing nor hearing what he was saying. He had to say it anyway. The Supreme Court, the lower courts, ruled that the statute was unconstitutional. And we were concerned that the Supreme Court might agree to review the case, but today they announced that they were not, which leaves our victory intact. And there was a line in the papers that we submitted to the Supreme Court that I really liked, because it summarized so much of what is going on now in these regulations that, you know, are ostensibly about women's health and are really about making abortion impossible to obtain. And the line said, this is farce, it's not medical practice.
Very Very good. Has there ever been a case where a brief written by the ACLU was rejected by the party it was attempting to support?
Well, here's the good news. The party who you're attempting to support doesn't have the right to reject the brief. Now, you know, generally speaking, if you're supporting the party, you want to support the party. But at least when you're talking about the Supreme Court, there are two ways to file the brief. Either the parties can consent, or if the parties do not consent, then you can ask the court for permission. And as a matter of practice, for an organization like ours, the court will always grant permission if the parties were to deny consent. And most people who practice in the Supreme Court understand that. And so both as a matter of just practicality and as a matter of courtesy, consent is usually pretty freely given.
And one final question, which I think will be relatively short. What important cases do you expect to reach the court next term?
There's going to be, there's very likely to be an abortion regulation case that reaches the Supreme Court, and that's going to be a big deal. There may be a big case coming out of Guantanamo that comes to the Supreme Court next year. And if that happens, that will be a big deal. And there is actually a very important voting rights case, or potentially very important voting rights case, that the court has already agreed to hear next year. So next year when we talk again, we'll be talking about probably voting rights, reproductive rights, and maybe Guantanamo.
Well, thank you, Steve.